Hey, you all, the governor's just extended the stay-at-home order. You've got armed militia once again going into the Capitol. When we come back, I'm going to talk to a man who's going to bring us forward beyond all this, because while all this madness is going on in Michigan, we have a census count to go for. When I come back, we'll be joined by Marc Morial, the head of the National Urban League. Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. My guest today is Marc Morial, the head of the National Urban League. Marc Morial, we have a major madness going on in Michigan over this COVID-19. But while we're dealing with that, we have a census count going on. Tell us why it's important to get that done.
The census is about money and it's about power in all Michiganders, from the Upper Peninsula down to Detroit. Have to be counted, because Michigan's one of those states that could lose congressional representation. A low count in Michigan means less dollars from the federal government coming to Michigan for the rebuilding it's going to have to do post-COVID. Please, I'm encouraging people, you got to be counted. It's simple. It's easy. Go online to mycensus.gov. Punch in your address, you can be counted. Or look for the form that's coming in the mail. Later on, there'll be door knockers coming to the homes of people who didn't participate either online or by mail. We have to be counted. We can't give up our rightful seat at the political table with an undercount.
When you say politics, what does it mean towards our representation in our state houses?
Well, in your state houses, I think it's important that a city like Detroit, which has lost population over the last 15 to 20 years, in order for it to maintain its representation in the Michigan legislature, both the House and the Senate, there has to be a full count of the number of people who live in Detroit. The city gives up power if it's not counted relative to the rest of the state. And for Michiganers all over, how your legislative seats are apportioned and reapportioned depends on the census count. So the best thing is for everyone to be counted completely, fully, and accurately in every county in Michigan. If that happens, then we know the chance for fair apportionment is much better.
When we come back, actually, you can start it now. Can you tell me what the effect on early education, Head Start, will be if we don't get counted fully?
Importantly, great question. The Head Start program is one of the great legacy programs of President Johnson's Great Society Initiative. It's made a huge difference in the lives of so many children to get that early start in education and socialization. The seats, the number of seats, and therefore the number of dollars allocated inside of the federal Head Start budget depends on the census count, how many children you have in your state. One thing you do on a census is you identify every person by date of birth, by gender, and by race. And by doing that, the federal government's got a baseline to know how many people are within each state who are children and therefore potentially eligible the Head Start program. So without it, without a full count, as we saw with Orlando, Florida, and I've used this example before, Orlando, Florida figured out that because of the undercount of 2010, they were losing out on 7,000 Head Start seats, or 7,000 slots for the young people of Orlando and Orange County, Florida.
Okay. Okay, when we come back, I want to talk about the other end of the spectrum and the middle end of the spectrum, which is the senior citizen services and also policing services that could be affected by all of this. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back with Marc Morial, the head of the National Urban League.
When I was a young girl, I made rounds at Harper Hospital with my dad. And being able to see the love that he was giving, I knew this was something special. DMC is where I started my journey in medicine, and it's where I'm living my journey in medicine. It's where I came back home. DMC Harper University Hospital is nationally acclaimed for research and teaching. And to me, it is still the home of medical care in Detroit. And I'm proud of that legacy. DMC, a community built on care.
Even in the face of the pandemic, we want to assure you, DTE is here to serve. Our dedicated crews are working 24/7 to provide the safe, reliable energy everyone in Michigan depends on. Especially now, we're thankful for the strength and resilience of each of our employees and all of our neighbors across the state. Remember, we're Michiganders. We're tough. We'll power through. DTE.
This is an important message from the Wayne County Treasurer, Eric Sabree.
Currently, the Wayne County Treasurer's office is closed to the public. This decision was made in order to mitigate the spread of the coronavirus. We are in total agreement with the governor's emergency declaration and the efforts of Wayne County leadership to protect the health and safety of our employees and the taxpayers who visit our office. Given the emergency declaration, we have suspended foreclosure activity for the 2020 calendar year. If you have delinquent taxes, they still must be paid. Taxpayers are encouraged to make tax payments by paying online at one of the 70 DivDat kiosks located throughout the county, through the U.S. Mail, or mobile app. For more information and updates, please visit the Wayne County Treasurer's website at treasurer.waynecounty.com or email us at taxinfo@waynecounty.com. We are all in this together. We don't know how long this emergency situation will last. I appreciate your patience and cooperation.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. My guest this morning is Marc Morial, the head of the National Urban League. Marc Morial, we talked about early childhood services, but what about senior services? How would they be affected if we don't get out the count?
Well, important programs like Medicare, which is critical to the health of seniors in this nation, those dollars are also part of a formula-based allocation system, which is based on the data in the census. These programs are based on how many people you have in the state. Many of the supplemental senior services, like the Seniors and Community Service Program, based on the census data. I can't underestimate how in our society, we moved to formula-based funding in many areas years ago to eliminate the abject politics that used to go on, where because some member of Congress had more power than another, their state would get a disproportionate amount of money. Well, certainly there's still ways that that can happen. But for many of these baseline programs, the funding formulas, the allocation, who gets resources is based on census derived data.
Okay. So what about policing?
Policing, I would say, you know, which is fundamentally a local function, there are probably some federal programs in the past that allocated dollars for law enforcement support based on census-derived data, but mostly not necessarily so in the policing area. But here's the most important thing. You want your community to have as much representation, power, and clout as it justly deserves, whether it's in the Congress, whether it's in the Michigan House, whether it's in the Michigan Legislature, or whether it's on the Detroit City Council or the Dearborn City Council or the Battle Creek City Council or the Pontiac City Council or the City Council of any local community in Michigan, right? So if your neighborhood is fully counted, you're going to have a chance to have more representation than if your neighborhood is undercounted and the neighborhood on the other side of town is fully counted.
Okay. Right now, we have a 14th congressional district that spans Detroit and Oakland County. That's Brenda Lawrence. We have a 13th congressional district, which is Detroit and some of the western suburbs, all right, which is currently Rashida Tlaib. If we do not get this count thing right, those two will face off against each other? I mean, if the things are cut.
It depends on what the Michigan legislature does. And I think, look, the legacy of Detroit, back to the Diggs Conyers, the Crockett Conyers, the legacy of Detroit has always been two African-American congressmen. That's been the legacy of Detroit for more than 50 years. And two congresspersons representing districts where there's a substantial number of peoples of color. I think it would be tragic if an undercount led to an effort to merge the districts of the two congresswomen that you just mentioned. And that's why it's so important that people are fully counted and that they're extremely active and vocal in the political process.
Okay. We've got a COVID-19 crisis going on at the same time the census count is happening. How do people respond to the census with all this madness happening?
So this is important. If you're staying at home, you can respond to the census by going online. If you're staying at home, you can respond to the census by filling out the form that comes in your mailbox. The safest way in the era of COVID to participate in the census is either by filling out the form or by going online. One form per dwelling, one form per house, one form per apartment. This is not where every individual has to fill out a form. I want to make sure people don't think that, but every house, every dwelling, every apartment, a form should be filled out for, and everyone in the dwelling, in the apartment, in the house, whether related by blood or marriage, should be counted.
Okay, Marc Morial, as I said, we have a COVID-19 crisis going on here in Michigan, as across the country. But the protests that were in Lansing, they started off with people in cars. Just a few weeks ago, they walked into the state house armed with AR-15s and body armor. When we come back, I want you to give us a little history lesson about the Black Panthers and their open carry, because Michigan's an open carry state. I want you to tell people what they may have missed about that protest. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back with Marc Morial, the head of the National Urban League.
The census doesn't matter. I don't see the impact.
Actually, Michigan gets $3,000 per person per year for 10 years to help fund schools, community food assistance, Medicaid, and more.
All right, I'll do it.
I'm kind of worried about my privacy.
The census is for everyone, but your data is not. Your answers to 9 basic questions will not be shared.
All right, I'm gonna do it.
Cool. Be counted today. Visit my2020census.gov.
Every success story starts with a spark of curiosity, of wanting more. Wayne County Community College District has more than 120 academic and career training programs and support to help you every step of the way. From registration to financial aid to career placement, find your spark and get on a path to your best life. Register today.
Welcome to the Center for Functional Health and Wellness, where we believe that many of your health conditions are connected, and we identify the underlying cause of your medical condition and treat the cause and not the symptoms. With over 20 years of experience, Dr. Somera Chapman has succeeded where others have failed. Call 248-569-8420 or visit naturalfunctions.com to schedule a consultation.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. My guest this morning is Marc Morial of the National Urban League. Marc Morial, I told you about the people marching on Lansing. They were protesting the governor's stay-at-home orders. They said it was too draconian. They started in just their cars, and some of them got out with a little social distancing. But just a few weeks ago, when the legislature came back into session, they actually came into the Capitol armed with AR-15s, and other semi-automatic rifles and body armor. Can you please give our audience a little bit of history of what happened when the Black Panthers did that?
Well, you know, back in the 1960s, the Panthers convened themselves for a protest in Sacramento, which is the state capital. And they convened themselves at the state capital, and they were armed with weapons that were allowed under California law. So there was no violation
for just the Panthers, like Michigan,
to do what they did. Now, Ronald Reagan, who was governor, his reaction to that was to try to pass gun control legislation in California to prevent people from doing what the Black Panthers had done at that time. I would see the protests. Look, the protests in Michigan, I'll never, ever seek to take away anyone's right to protest. However, one must understand those protests are politically organized. They're organized by forces probably close to the president. They remind me of the Tea Party movement. Notwithstanding those protests, the vast majority of people believe that the economies of states and cities should not be open until there's some guarantee of a plan for safety, till there's enough testing, till there's sufficient hospital beds and PPEs for people, until workplaces and government, the private sector, adopt a set of rules, whether it's some sort of social distancing rules, that keep people safe.
But these people didn't seem to understand it. Okay. And
well, it may be less wanting to understand and more wanting to play politics with the governor. You wonder if the previous governor were governor, if they would be doing the same thing. I mean, there's a partisan dimension to this. I think people can see there's a partisan dimension to this. It tracks, you know, the Trump administration's Department of Justice saying we're going to take action against states that don't end social distancing. I mean, some of this, a lot of this is just political theater of the 21st century.
Okay. It's theater of the 21st century, but I think it's also very, very dangerous because everybody can see the news where Detroit is hit harder by the COVID-19 crisis than the rest of the state. And I can actually see a point where people say, well, just shut Detroit down and let us go. I can see that happening. What do we do at that point?
Repeat your question.
My question was, what do we do if the governor is forced to make a decision geographically because Detroit is hit harder by the COVID-19 crisis than the rest of the state?
Well,
and that's fact.
Yes. So in New York, the governor of New York has laid out the framework for phased reopening. And some parts of the state may reopen earlier than others, depending on the data. And the key is whether there have been a spike or a decrease in hospitalizations over here in New York. They're talking about a 14-day period. And I think people have to be guided by the numbers. But you can't just pull numbers out of the air or create artificial barriers. Right now, look, if I think it's commonsensical that if you still have deaths increasing, hospitalizations increasing, that means infections are increasing, why would you end the stay-at-home order?
Mm-hmm. That's obvious. It's a no-brainer to me.
Yeah, so there's a high degree of political gamesmanship going on here. And I hope that the governor will ignore the political gamesmanship. But I also hope that those, you know, there's nothing that prevents those who feel strongly about maintaining health of doing their own mobilization, doing their own act of political disobedience, so to speak.
So you think that us African-American open carry advocates should show up at the Capitol and threaten the Republicans?
No, I didn't say that. I said it would be within your rights if you wanted to stage a counter protest. But I don't even know if that's a productive use of time.
I don't think it is.
I don't know who's following that, those protests, except the media and the people who are hardcore adherents. And the governor should stick to her guns, which I'm sure she will, and open the state when she believes and the data shows that people can stay safe.
Okay. When we come back for our last segment, I want to talk about the future of America post COVID-19 from the perspective of the National Urban League. Can you help us with that?
What first sparked your curiosity? Drove you to learn more, to be better, to achieve things, and go places you couldn't have imagined before? At WCCCD, you can discover or rediscover your spark for learning and find your path to your best life. Want more? Start here. Register today.
Kemp Funeral Home, where lasting memories are uniquely yours. The beautiful chapel holds nearly 300 guests.
Our services are as unique as your life and your loved one's life.
Plus, a spacious lobby and a separate repast parlor. Kemp Funeral Home in Southfield is helping families prepare before their time of need by offering free monthly seminars on all aspects of funeral planning. Call today for a free consultation, 248-702-5367.
Hello, I'm Dr. Shauna Diggs, and welcome to Cosmetic Dermatology.
As Michigan's leader in comprehensive skin health and rejuvenation, board-certified dermatologist Dr. Shauna Ryder Diggs and the entire Cosmetic Dermatology team take a caring, customized approach to skin care. The Cosmetic Derm team effectively treats skin diseases and autoimmune diseases, such as lupus. State-of-the-art laser technology is utilized in hair removal, tattoo removal, and skin peels. To learn more, visit our website, Cosmetic Dermatology, where science and beauty meet.
Mike's Fresh Market, Detroit's largest independent supermarket with the best prices, quality, and service. Enjoy our vast selection of fresh fruits and vegetables. Wide aisles lead you to our own in-house bakery and deli. Beef, pork, chicken, seafood, and much more. You can rest assured you will feed your family the freshest food in town. Whatever you need, you can find it here at Mike's Fresh Market. Mike's Fresh Market with two locations, Gratiot and 7 Mile and Livernois and 7 Mile. Better food, better prices. That's Mike's promise.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. My guest this morning is Marc Morial, the head of the National Urban League. Marc Morial, thank you for being with us this morning. We're about to wrap this thing up. Before I let you go, you know, the National Urban League has been around over 100 years.
110 to be exact.
110 years. What does America look like post-COVID-19? We've got a high unemployment rate now. Is that going to come back down? Are we in a Great Depression? What's going to go on from your perspective?
We have the power, meaning we as a generation have the power to determine and direct that this nation will come back in the right way. It will not happen serendipitously. It will not happen automatically. There's no autopilot on the economy. There's no autopilot on our cities, our states, or the national government. So I'm optimistic, but I'm realistic. And I realize it's going to take a tremendous amount of effort and a tremendous amount of work for us to just stand back on our feet. People are hurting. People are suffering. More people are going to hurt. 30 million people unemployed. We've not even begun to count the number of people who are behind on their mortgages, behind on their utility bills, behind in the payment on their credit cards, behind on their broadband bills, because the economic pain has been so dramatic and so difficult. It's going to require a response, continuing response from our national government and a response from the leading business and, if you will, philanthropic institutions in our nation to respond to this. To one, first, make sure people keep their heads above water. And number two, we have to reform and rebuild this nation's economy in a way that's far more balanced, more fair, and more equitable. We've seen in America too many Americans living check to check. We've seen in America the wealth and the income transfer automatically to the top time and time again.
To the African-American community, which is largely a consumer-based community and not a producer, What do you suggest that the African-American community do coming out of this post-COVID-19?
Well, I think so much of our power is our power of political engagement, democracy, and voting. We have to vote and hold our national government accountable. They're the big player in this. They're the big player in this. They have the only institution that has the wherewithal and the resources to be able to invest and direct. But we, on a local level, we on an organizational level, I think have to put people first and make sure equity and fairness are in the conversation.
Okay. Marc Morial, how do people support the National Urban League?
You may go to nul.org and become an online subscriber of the National Urban League, as well as contribute dollars if you see fit. You can get involved with one of our great affiliates there in the state of Michigan. I would identify the Urban League in Detroit, the Detroit Urban League, longtime 100-year-old organization. The Urban League of Southwestern Michigan, which is in Battle Creek, and in Grand Rapids, we have an Urban League affiliate chapter. We've got interest groups working on establishing a presence or reestablishing a presence in places like Flint. But we have a presence on the ground, and you can be a part of that and be a part of the national effort, too.
Okay. Marc Morial, I want to thank you for joining us this morning. It's been a real pleasure, a real eye-opener. And I hope people get the real semblance of those people open carrying in Lansing. And I hope they get the importance of filling out that census and what it means to Detroit. So just thank you for helping
us. Last thing, I've got a book coming out, The Gumbo Coalition.
That's right.
The leadership book comes out on May 5th. Available on Amazon online. That's the Gumbo Coalition. Talk to you about leadership.
Hey, man, I've got at least two candidates for state representative I'm buying that book for. I'm going to do that book.
A lot of insight here.
All right. And ladies and gentlemen, we need your help staying on the air. If you can cash app us, $ Steve Hood Show, you'll keep independent programming on the air. Have an awesome week. Stay safe.
Stay healthy.
Stay healthy.
The preceding program was paid for by Ronin America, DMC, Wayne County Treasurer's Office, DTE, WCCCD, the Center for Functional Health, Kemp Funeral Home, Amada Senior Care, Dr. Shauna Diggs, and Mike's Fresh Market.